This episode of The Get Down is brought to you by Digital Music Pool. Digital Music Pool is the ultimate record pool for professional DJs looking for the hottest tracks and exclusive hits updated daily in an easy-to-use platform. You can find exclusive edits from myself, Cream, Adam B., Andrew Marks, Angela the Kid, Chumpion, Castra, and Pat C., only on DMP, and we're giving you a chance to try their service for just $9.99 for the first month and $24.99 each additional month. All you have to do is click the link in the show notes or on the Get Down or Cream Instagram pages, create an account, and enter the promo code CREAM at checkout for your discounted month. DMP is my go-to site when downloading new music, so become a member for just $9.99 for the first month with the code CREAM. You will not be disappointed. Click the link in the show notes or on the Get Down or Cream Instagram pages to sign up now. What's up, guys? Thanks for listening to the Get Down podcast. If you enjoy what you hear and you think other DJs could benefit from the things that we talk about on the show, we would greatly, greatly appreciate if you could subscribe, rate, and review our podcast wherever you listen to it. It's much appreciated. Thanks, guys. This episode is our very first Digital Music Pool Artist Spotlight with DJ producer Pat C on the show. If you're listening to this episode, you most certainly have Pat C music in your crates, and we discuss how he got into producing music, growing his brand on MySpace, and eventually blowing up on Crooklyn Clan. Pat C's journey is a unique one, and we dig into why he stopped DJing for a few years, why he's making his return to nightlife, and what challenges he's facing now that many new DJs are also facing. Finally, we dig into being persistent versus being annoying, and what's the best way to approach bookers, build those relationships, and book more gigs. Let's get into this episode of The Get Down with Pat C. All right, what's up, guys? Welcome to the 102nd episode of The Get Down presented by Digital Music Pool. My name is Cream.
Gary W here.
All right, and this episode we have a guest and we're starting our DMP Artist Spotlight. Is that what we're calling this, Gary?
Yeah, I think that's a good way to put it.
So we have our man Pat C on the show. Pat, what's up, man?
What's up, guys? Thanks for having me. I really appreciate this.
For sure, man. I think it's a no-brainer for us to start working in some of the DMP guys. And you're one of the originals, right?
Yeah, I don't know if I was the first. I don't remember who was before me, if that was the case. But yeah, it's been a while. I think 2016, 2017, maybe.
Yeah, man.
So yeah, when they started taking on exclusives.
Dope. I love it.
You were just like a natural pick. We looked at all the exclusive editors and we're like, well, Pat's obviously got to be the first one. Not only because you were probably one of the, if not the first.
Yeah.
But just somebody that Cream and myself have had in our crates forever, for as long as I can remember. So this is just an easy one.
Yeah, I'm sure everybody listening also.
Yeah, serious.
That's the goal, man. Getting as many crates as possible, you know?
So we're going to get into your story. And I think it's unique because you have like a pretty cool story to tell. But before we get into that, I have to share something that happened to me at a show this weekend. And I want to get your guys' take on it. But Saturday night, I'm playing in New York City. It was Santa Con in New York on Saturday. So it was a shit show. Like, getting in, it almost took me 2 hours to get into the city and get to the venue. But every venue was packed the whole day. I started my set, and within the first, like, first of all, before I even started playing, I opened the computer, I'm getting requests, number one. But number two, like the first 10 songs into my set, I'm literally having a dude in a Santa costume boo me. And if you're not watching the video, I'm booing myself right now. And it was just like it was just a range of emotions that took place, right? It was like instant anger. Like, who the fuck is this guy to boo me? I just started DJing. Like, everyone's dancing. Shut up. Then it was like, where's security? Because I want to kick this guy out.
Wow.
And then number three, it was like, all right, it's just some loser that's like probably wasted. And I'm just going to like let it go and just move on and not focus on him and focus on everybody else. But has that ever happened to you? And like, how do you react?
Dude, real quick, because can we name the place? Because it happened to me at that place in the first and the same thing, like in the first 10 minutes of me DJing.
It's a big time college Lower East Side spot. I don't know if we should name the place, but okay. I mean, so if you really want to find out where it was, you go look at where I played last week.
Right. So I just feel like in those instances where, you know, everybody's been out all day long and they've been drinking all day, and the last DJ probably was super high energy because that was really the bulk. That was like really the headline SantaCon set, was that afternoon evening set, right? That kind of led into the night. Those people that stuck around afterward, I mean, they're out and they're zombies apparently, you know, at that point usually. So you're probably setting up your night. You have a longer set. So you're trying to just set the night up to where you can lead into your peak hour. And this guy's been peak for the last 4 hours. So like, you know, that's kind of where that probably came from. I'm imagining that you weren't like going EDM banger at 10:15, but I mean, I don't know, maybe you were. But, you know, that's going to happen. It's going to happen from time to time. And it happened to me there because it was the same thing. Some guy was out drinking all day on Saturday afternoon. And then he led into at 10:15 during my set. He, you know, it was like a nice boo. It was just like a hands down and a smile kind of a thing.
Yeah.
I just kind of laughed it off. And you know, that's all you can do in those situations.
So disrespectful. Laugh it off. It's like super disrespectful.
Pat, what do you think about this? I don't know. I don't know if it's ever happened to you.
I don't know if I've ever been booed per se, but I think if it's just one person in the crowd, you know, I really wouldn't worry about it too much. It's just, any DJ will know this with experiences that you can't please everyone in the crowd. You're always going to have that one person that wants EDM when you're playing hip hop and hip hop when you're playing EDM. And it's just, or, you know, they want traditional Bengali music. You know, it's just like there's always going to be those people, you know, and, you know, now the whole Bad Bunny thing is, so if you don't play Bad Bunny, they're going to get pissed off. And it's, you can't, there's no possible way to please everyone. There's no possible open format genres that can just, it's impossible.
Yeah, agreed.
It's hard. Yes. It's hard because we're people first, right? And it's like, if someone's booing you or telling you you're doing a bad job, I think everyone's immediate reaction would be like, well, fuck you. Like, I'm not doing a bad job. I've been doing this for a long time. I think I'm pretty good at my job. But it's like, in what other industry can someone, like, can I go to, I'm going to go to Chick-fil-A and my sandwich didn't come out hot, and I'm just going to boo the guy who made, the chef who made my sandwich. Like, in what world does this happen in any other job or line of work?
Cream, this happens all the time. In the hospitality business, this happens all the time. As everybody knows who listens to this, you know, I frequent Disney over here, and I see these poor people getting chewed out left and right constantly for stuff that's not even within their control. You know what I mean? At least the music's within your control, you know? But like, you know, you just see it all the time in hospitality business because people are just, they've lost touch with like any kind of reality when it comes to the service industry. It's insane. Actually, within the hour of you getting booed and you texting me that you got booed and you trying to get this guy thrown out, within the hour, one of our other DJs texts me the same exact thing that some guy came up to and go, you fucking suck. That's what he told to him. Like, that's way worse.
Oh my God.
I would have had him thrown out immediately because that's aggressive. He said he came around the DJ booth and told him, point that at him, you fucking suck.
Do you think asking security to throw the person out is like overstepping, or do you think that's fair?
I don't know. I don't think you should throw him out just because he's probably drunk and just disgruntled. He'll forget about it in 2 seconds when you play a song that he actually does like. And, you know, the thing with alcohol is that people just, they're not going to remember it. So like, they're not going to know why they got kicked out or anything. And it's going to cause a problem in the future. And I don't know, just try to stay away from that. Unless they're actually physically, verbally abusing you, like angry. I don't know. I think they shouldn't be thrown out. It's just, you got to, you know, just ignore it in a sense with people like that. They're just drunk idiots.
Yeah.
you know what? You take the request or you take the boo, whatever it might be. And then they come back. And if they continually come back, I've had this happen a million times where the person comes back and comes back and comes back again. And now they're trying to touch the DJ equipment. Now you get thrown out.
That's right. It.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's crossing the line.
Right.
Something that I like to do too, which in this particular case, we didn't have a microphone at this venue. The venue just doesn't really like it. So normally if someone is doing that to me and it's like one individual person, I'll literally spin out of the music. I've done it before. And you jump on the mic and you're like, whatever, XYZ venue, like you guys having a good time. Well, this guy right here is booing me. What do you guys think about that? And it, like, it's a way to interact with the crowd. And like, they kind of like get behind you more because you point that person out, because most of the other people were having a good time. And it's like, fuck this guy, like boo this guy or whatever. Yeah. Sometimes yeah, you get a really cool like interaction with the, with your crowd if you actually like point it out at somebody.
Yeah. Nothing's better than embarrassing the asshole. And, you know, everyone's for you at that case. Everyone starts booing him, you know, so karma in a way.
That's really funny. I think I've only actually had somebody thrown out once, and it's because they literally like got physical with me.
Yeah. Wow. I've had a few people thrown out for like what I said before. They were either touching the DJ equipment or the guy. I've had a guy walk by and like scratch a record and like keep going. And like, I had to go find the guy. Yeah. Crazy. Like when I was in like a smaller bar where people were within like arm's length, that definitely happened a few times, but
yeah. Touching the DJ or the DJ equipment is like instant, like insane. Zero tolerance for either one of those.
So somebody closed my laptop once. They like literally just pushed it shut.
Oh my
and
God.
I mean, I was at that point, I didn't have to say anything. The security saw it because the music stopped. And then eventually they just had it thrown out. But like, I mean, like not even a no, like warning, just a bloop. And like the music obviously goes off, you know? So, but that's just part of the business. I mean, you can't stop that. You have to have like a, it should be like a few feet of like barrier, at least if in the front of the, you know, yeah. prevent the side. You can see them coming, but like people come up, oh, can I you play this and that? And then you can't stop them from just kind of just like pushing them. They yeah, can play their song.
Some venues, you just have no room. There's just no space between you and the crowd. You know, it is what it is, but.
So yeah, what I want to transition to right now is.
That's a big one.
What I want to transition to is, so Pat, you kind of like took a step back from actually DJing out and, mm-hmm. you know, you were still playing here and there, but I know you're making a stronger push right now to get back into DJing regularly. So can you talk about like that journey and why you initially stopped and then now why you're getting back into it?
Yeah. So, all right, I'll start from the beginning here. So, you know, I started DJing around 2004, 2005, you know, I was like a promoter, so I was like kind of that way in a sense. And, you know, basically played the same few clubs in Queens and stuff like that is kind of where I started out. And I started getting booked more outside, you know, city, Jersey, all this stuff. Around, I was doing pretty well. I had a bunch of residencies in 2015, 2016. I just got sick of it. It was like the politics of the industry more than anything that really kind of pushed me away, is like dealing with promoters when, you know, every DJ will kind of have this same thing with like promoters, is that they always want you to bring people. They want you to do the tables. Meanwhile, they're the promoters and that's supposed to be their job. And I don't want to sound like the angry DJ and old head, you know, but I get it as part of like the business, but I didn't want to do it. I had some bad interactions with some promoters. This one promoter came to me and was like, you know, I was a resident and stuff like that. I was always doing well. And I kind of didn't bring people for, and he goes, hey, your numbers are down this week. And I just kind of looked at him and I was like, my numbers are down this week. How are your numbers this week? You know, like how's my music this week? As opposed to like my numbers, you know, like I felt like that shouldn't be the DJ's job, but you know, I get it as part of the industry. So I don't want to say that, but that's one of the things that really set me off. And I didn't want to go back to that. And unless I was, it made me lose the love of the industry. Cause I, you know, you had to worry about how many people you were bringing as opposed to what you were playing that week. And it, you know, just, you lose that loving feeling for like playing when you have to do all stuff like that. Yeah. So it just made me not want to DJ. So for a few years, I think 2016, I kind of stopped taking bookings. I would only really do favors for people, really, essentially. You know, like if I would do the DMP Christmas party, I'd do anything for them. You know, I'd play that, no problem. You know, and then I kind of just was like, you know, I always loved DJing. So it's just, I wanted to get back into it. I just didn't want to deal with that aspect of the industry. So I told myself, if I'm ever going to go back, I'm not dealing with promoters. I'm not doing the book this table, bring this many people. Like, if you ask me that, you're like, I'm not dealing with you. So go through like the DJs that do the bookings, you know, because they care more about the music. I'll always like try to bring people to the venue. I don't want to get it wrong where I won't bring people and like this and that. but I'm not going to guarantee you X amount of people. This is how I've always, it's always going to be about the music for me. And, you know, I'm going to push the party, you know, it's what you should do, but I'm not going to promise you I'm bringing this amount of people. And if I don't bring that many people, you won't book me again. I'm not dealing with that. No, I'm kind of just, I just want into the game that way and, you know, have it just be about music.
We've been lucky to kind of get away from that recently in recent years. Cream, correct me if I'm wrong, but I feel like, you know, that, I mean, I guess because we're doing a lot of the bookings locally, so we're not dealing with too many promoters. I mean, the reasons that you said is the reasons that Cream and I had started Get Down, because we were getting older even, you know, 5-6 years ago, and it was like, well, I don't have as many friends that are coming out anymore.
Exactly.
You know, how can we get a stronghold on doing the things that we like to do without dealing with the promotion side of it, like you said. So, but I feel like in recent years, especially post pandemic, it has been a little more hands off on expecting the DJ to bring a ton of people. And there is a little more onus now on the music you play and, you know, at the DJ actually being talented. And I think that has to do with people being a little more educated too. People, you know, consuming more DJ sets, whether it be on SoundCloud or what, you know, YouTube or whatever it might be. And I feel like that has helped our industry as DJs.
Also, I feel like for a long time, especially in New York City, because that's what we're talking about, right? That's where that promoter-driven bookings really started. Mm-hmm. And like you said, Garrett, it was one of the reasons why we pulled out of New York a little bit, because just dealing with that politics and the BS was like not fun. You know, it makes DJing not fun when you have to worry about all this other stuff instead of actually, you know, performing. Now, of course you got to promote the party. Of course, if you could sell tables or bring people out, that's great, you know, but you shouldn't be booked or not booked based on that. I think what we're seeing now is there are more DJs that are actually holding like the entertainment director or booker. They're doing it more. And right. I think because of that, we're seeing less of this promoter driven thing. It still exists, of course. But I think the DJs booking other DJs, you know, I'm booking people, right? I ask the question from owners, managers, do you want someone that is going to DJ the room the way you need it to be DJed? Or do you want someone that's a promoter DJ?
Exactly.
And I ask that question a lot of times because there's a huge difference, you know, there's a huge difference. And understanding those goals of the venue or the person who's throwing the party up front for us is important. And it is what it is, right? It's like,
it's very difficult to be good at both, right? It's very difficult to be a great DJ and a great promoter at the same exact time, you know? And a lot of times when you are a better promoter, you can bring out people, you're usually younger and less experienced than some of the other guys.
Well, that's what it is. That's what it
really
is.
What it comes down to.
Yeah, once you get into your 30s, it's like our friends aren't coming out as much. They have families, they're settled down. They don't go out as much. So it's just harder.
Yeah. That's how I started as a promoter, you know? So it was easier. I was 18, 19, 20. All my friends were going to that venue anyway. So it'd be easy to do 50, 60 people on guest list. Like that was nothing, you know, I had a promotion. You get older, like your friends move away. I move away. I live an hour north of the city. Imagine like even me traveling out to like Jersey or something is, but like a lot of my friends are up here now too. And it's like, I'm not going to tell them, yo, you want to make this hour and a half trip to Jersey or the city to like come out and see me play. They can be like, no, like I have a kid and a wife, like, you know, like most people my age are like married with kids. Like I'm not going to bring them out and I'm not going to go out and network and meet younger kids just to, for the purpose of like networking. Like that seems a little too like out of my, like, you know, like I'm not going to do that. I don't know.
So I think you face some unique challenges because, you know, you were in the game heavy, you pulled back a little bit, and now you're working your way back in. So like, what are some of the challenges you're facing right now, besides just the travel and the distance of booking more shows again?
Yeah. It's more of like, you know, I'm the person that's like not really going to reach out to people. been my issue for a long time. I'm not going to be like, hey, you know, I'm kind of looking at stuff like that. If I know you, I might. But like, I'm not going to reach out to really to random people and be like, hey, you know, I heard you're playing this place. Can you put me in? I'll never do that. I don't know if it's pride. I don't know what it is. I've just never been the person to do that. But that's like a little bit of a setback too. I think you kind of have to be aggressive, regardless of people, they know you in all this sense. I think, you know, people will forget you if you don't pop up on the line, and they're not going to reach out to you. Maybe he's not going to be willing to play my little bar or whatever the play. But, you know, I don't know how people view people, you know, other people. They might not think you would play there or something, you know, but I'm willing to play anywhere. I just want to play, you know, in a sense, for at least for right now. I don't mind playing any little bar, whatever. I just want to be able to play again. It's all about getting that experience back. The crowds have changed. The music has changed. You know, the whole industry. And you have to play basically anywhere. You have to be willing to start over is kind of how I feel. Like I'm that's the position I'm in right now. I'm starting almost from scratch. Like I have the experience of playing, but it's so different now. Like whatever the whole industry compared to 2016 is a whole new game right now.
Yeah. I mean, it changes every 6 months, I feel like, at this point. But you said something earlier that like, you don't want to be annoying. So my question to you is how do you feel? Because Cream and I deal with this all the time. How do you deal with being persistent versus being annoying? You know, because at some point, like you do, like you said, you have to be persistent. You have to stay on people's radar, whether that's, you know, a text message or popping up at a gig or a DM, whatever it might be. But at some point, you can get quite annoying. Like somebody can get quite annoying. So, like, how do you toe that line? Like, I know it's kind of a feel thing, but how do you personally toe that line?
Yeah, I look at it like from the other person, like as if like someone's hitting me up. Like, if you hit me up more than once, I'm gonna be like, kind of like, all right, I get it. And I see it, and I respond. You know, like when you hit me up again, like, and it's not something where like I actually forgot, I'm gonna be like, all right, kind of. So I'll hit someone up maybe once, and if you don't like follow through, like I'm not gonna hit you up again unless you hit me back. It's kind of, it's always, you know, the same thing. Even like with like a chick, if you're like, you know, the same thing. If you don't want to double text, kind of like, you know, like it's kind of same way.
I never thought about it like that, but you're pretty much it's right. It's like you're courting someone, quote unquote, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Whether it's a booker or, you know, if you're single and you're trying to find a girlfriend, it's kind of similar where it's like you want to be persistent, but you don't want to be annoying. And I don't think a lot of people know how to toe that line. And I think that's where a lot of DJs run into some problems because they do become annoying. And it's like, if once you become annoying for me, I don't want to book you, you know, like, exactly. And I think that goes for most bookers. If you cross that line into being annoying, most bookers, I don't think are going to want to work with you.
Yeah. I mean, and then if you get booked, you better over deliver. You know what I mean? You better bring people. You better perform and you better bring people. You
should,
know,
I, because... should I tell the story, Gar?
Yeah, please.
All right, so something that's literally just happened. There's been a DJ that's been hitting me up to play one of the venues that we book and been hitting me up consistently, you know, a number of times, 5, 6, 7, 8 times, some of which weren't answered, like where I didn't respond because I was either DJing, like they were texting me on a Friday night and I'm at work and I'm like, this is not the time to be texting someone that can book you type thing. So I gave it to the kid. I was like, you know what? He really wants to work with us. And I'm like, let's give him a booking. You know, he's been a little bit annoying, but let's like see if it works out. Give him the booking. And then they cancel last minute. And by last minute, I mean like the week of type thing. And it's like, I was saying to Gary, I'm like, what do I say to this kid? Do I like give him the hard truth? Or do I just say like, all right, man. And like never hit him up again, you know?
I think in those situations, you have to just tell the truth, you know, and be like, listen, like you were persistent almost to the point of annoying to be nice. And then, you know, be like, I decided to put you in the spot. And now like a couple of days before you're going to cancel, like this doesn't put you in great standing. Right. Like, and I think that should be just known. You and I think that's common sense, right? Oh, I should now know that I'm not in good standing, but we've dealt with enough people to know that like common sense isn't always the overbearing thing here. And you think, and like simple stuff like that needs to be explained, because some people just don't have that business sense, right? Like they just don't know that, like, oh, I'm going to burn a bridge here and that's going to be it. And you have to kindly explain that, but it's a, you know, because some people just unfortunately don't get it at the end of the day.
Yeah. Sometimes I feel like we have to put our, you know, we wear this like coach mentor hat sometimes, where sometimes I just want to be a dick. And then sometimes I'm like, you know what? I feel like this is a good opportunity to explain to this person why this is probably not the right thing to do.
Right.
Because then it's like the next time he'll do it the right way, you know?
Yeah, well, exactly.
So what is the right way? I think that would help our listeners a lot. Like, what's the right way to be persistent, but not be annoying?
I guess, like, again, I'm more of a shy person, so maybe it's not the best advice, but if you really are, just be as nice as possible. Don't overdo it. Don't be like, hi, you know, like one of those like people, or like, hey, can you put me in this place? Like, and it's like the biggest venue, like, you know, like how, like, no, like start from the ground up. Hey, I'm willing to play anywhere. If you have any opportunities, I would really appreciate it. I can do this and that for you, you know, kind of present something that you can kind of bring to the table as well, especially if you're like no one, you know, kind of, I think that's just the approach. I think, you know, just be as nice as possible to begin with, you know, and don't like beg and like ask and push and like, you know, kind of, yeah.
Yeah. You've nailed it. I mean, you first of all have to know your value, which is difficult to know, you know, because in our industry, we've said this time and again, you need to be confident. You need to be a little cocky, right? To be successful in our business. But you also have to know where you stand. You have to know your standing within the DJ community, right? And then having that value prop, what are you bringing to the table? What are you doing for me in order for me to book you? And then in order to get to that place, yes, you do have to be persistent, but you have to toe the line. Maybe it's go out and see that DJ, right? Go down and see that DJ once. Follow up with them via DM 2 days later, right? If you don't hear from them, maybe you go pop in again the following weekend. And if nothing comes of it after that, well, then you know what? You might want to try to hang it up and move on and try something else. So... I mean, I think you nailed it there.
I don't need to add anything because you guys covered the whole thing. I mean, I think that was super spot on. I think if you're a younger DJ and you're hitting people up, I would say this. If you hit someone up, try and hit them up on obviously not the weekend where people are working, whether they're a DJ or a promoter or whatever. Once Thursday night, Friday hits, everyone's thinking about like the events for the weekend and they're not worried about, oh, I need to book DJs for a month away. No one is thinking about that. So I would say the smart move would be to hit up the bookers Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, one of those days, like midday type thing, you know? Like don't hit people up at 11 p.m., 12 at night. Yeah, you have to like do it that way. And then I'd say reach out, ask, show your value, and then wait a couple weeks, right? If they don't answer you back, leave it, let it be. Maybe two, three weeks later, hit that person up again and say, hey man, I know you're really busy. You know, you don't have to get back to me right away, but XYZ, whatever you want to say. And then after that, if they don't answer you, I think the move is to go see them in person, you know?
Yeah.
Offer something. Hey, Kareem, can I open for you? Hey, Pat, can I, you know, can I send you an edit pack? Hey, Gary, can I do this? That's a great way to ingrain yourself. Hey, promoter, I have a table that I'm going to send you on Saturday. Here's the person's name. Here's the contact. Those are all ways for a booker and promoter to remember you instantly. And the next time there's an opportunity, maybe they say, oh shit, this DJ sent me a table or did this. Let's give them a shot. And I think that's the best way to do it.
I kind of laughed when you said the timing thing, because last week, it was just a little behind the scenes thing. Like I hit up Kareem about a bunch of business stuff on Friday. He had a big gig Friday night, Pat. And I'm like, telling him like, oh, like I have this thought for this venue and I'm going to book this person here on Saturday. And for this afternoon, he's like, dude, he's like, I'm not doing anything related to booking. Nothing. He's like, I got a big gig tonight. I'm traveling. I'm downloading, organizing and trying to create an edit or two. He's like, just, I'm not doing this today. And I'm his fucking business partner. Like, so forget like So forget it if you're hitting him up like 10 p.m. on a Friday. Like, you're not getting booked. Like, it's just, you have to be a little smarter about things.
So there's definitely like an overwhelm of hitting people up too. You know, people have a lot going on and then you hit them at the wrong time. Someone off. Not everyone is nice. And like, you know, I try to be calm and level-headed, but not everyone is like that. So people don't know how to handle pressure and being overwhelmed with like so many things. And in our industry, that's very common. Just people just, you know, there's just so much going on, especially on the weekend. You guys are always busy, so I can't imagine, but you know, I don't want to hit that one at the wrong time and just be on their bad side.
I think one final thing, and then we can move on, but if you're hitting someone up and they haven't answered you, it might not be because they don't want to book you or they don't want to answer you. Like you said, they just might have a lot of stuff going on. So I think another great tactic, if someone's not answering you, or even if they are, pop out to the venue that they're either promoting or working at and show some love, buy some drinks, you know, bring the DJ a drink. Like, I think those are all good ways to just create a relationship. And that's how a lot of these bookings are coming, is through relationships. Bookers want to book people that they know, that they like, that they feel confident are going to do a good job. And I think if you don't know this person, you've never met them before, or you don't have a good relationship, you got to work on the relationship side of it, as well as showing how you could do a good job for them as a DJ. So,
yeah, I think it's great advice.
All right. So, Pat, I want to get more into, you know, your music production and your edits. I think something that's been really cool that you've been doing lately is you've been doing a lot of like live video edits, and they're really dope. I think they've been getting good traction. I know a lot of other DJs have been like reposting your stuff. So what made you kind of take that path?
Yeah, that's something that that took a lot of me to do, because I didn't want to be that, you know, that old guy that's like kind of TikToking, you know, kind of like that whole thing. But it's something you have to adapt to in the industry, and it's either adapt or get left behind. Nowadays it's like, I really have another outlet to kind of play my music. So if I'm not doing live events, you know, my music's kind of behind a paywall in a sense on DMP. So every time I try to post music on my Instagram, it would get no like traction, because I guess the algorithm just doesn't like music. I would get like literally like 30, 40 views if I just posted like the mashup or whatever. I don't know. So something with the algorithm just isn't right. But I think they want you to like engage through reels and like all this stuff. I don't really know too much about it, but this is just what I was told. So, you know, I'm like, you know what, let me try to, you know, do that. I don't really like being on video and stuff. So I'm like, you know what, I'll just suck it up and see how it goes and see if it works. And it was working. So, you know, I started doing those. I haven't done one in a while, but I try to, it's my way of staying relevant, I guess, you know? So I think you have to do stuff like that.
It's a really creative way to stay relevant on social media in the way that you should be without really having to show your face and being this energetic persona on video, which maybe you're not, right? Mm-hmm. 'Cause I know like that's something that like it wouldn't translate for me at all. Like, it would look forced. So I think there was a really creative way to do that. It's a good idea. I would never even think to do something like that.
It checks a lot of boxes, right? It gets your music out there. You're using the social media platforms that you kind of have to use right now to be successful. And you're showcasing your skills, because live remixing is not you just playing a song that you created in Ableton. Mm-hmm. You're showing that you could bring something else to the table. So I think it's really smart. I think you should go all in on it. And I think it's going to really help you, to be honest, like with bookings and with your music. I mean, a lot of people know your music and play your music. I think them seeing it pop up on socials will just like further that and help grow your fan base even more. And it'll help your originals and other stuff that you're doing. So I'm all about it. I think it's awesome.
Speaking of originals, I dug into your originals a bunch this week, and I don't know, just I found that like you do a couple, you know, you did a trap type track, and then you have, you know, obviously a bunch of high energy house stuff. Maybe just like dig into your process and kind of how you started to produce originals.
Oh man, originals started, that was that, you know, production was my first it started, you know, 2002, 2003. I got inspired. You know, I heard Through the Wire by Kanye West, and I was like, this is insane. So I had a friend in high school who kind of knew how to make beats. So I had him show me. the whole way of like, you know, how to do this and that. So I sucked at first. It was hard. I sucked for years, actually. But I started to learn how to sample. And I kind of learned all of that stuff on my own. And, you know, doing hip hop beats and stuff like that. I actually started on MySpace, believe it or not. Like my first big platform where I like did very, very well. I would have like millions of views on MySpace. Very, very odd. I would just do mashups. I would do these hip hop beats with like these like rap vocals with like house samples. It was just this crazy stuff. And it would do so well. And then Beatbreaker had found me on there. And that's, you know, I started like with the whole Crooklyn Clan thing. I'll get into that later. But as far as like originals, I've always wanted to like just do something different. And like my creative process, it's like I kind of get inspired by like sounds I hear as opposed to like, you know, a song I hear. If I hear sound, I'm like, I can take the sound and kind of put it into the song and make it this way. So, you know, I don't really like hear this song and want to make something like it. I'll hear a sound and how can I make this into what's current and popular now and just make it different and kind of, you know, I just do stuff like that. And I've always kind of kept that motto from like the beginning. It's just always sounds always drew me in, you know, that the sound banks going through the sound banks is something sticks out to you and all that stuff. So it's kind of just as far as originals, that's just kind of what I've always stuck to. And I have a really good ear for like what sounds good and like good vocals and stuff like that too. You know, so, you know, you throw a good vocal in there and it's always a good thing.
So recently getting back into DJing, do you think that what you're seeing out there while you're DJing is impacting how you're producing currently?
Again, the outside world doesn't really influence me. But what you hear like is like, you know, tech house is relevant now. So right. You kind of want to go a little bit more of like a tech house route. And like, you know, I try not to stay to the, everyone's taking these like old 90s, 2000s vocals and putting them over. I don't try to do that. I try to kind of do my own thing, but still stay in the realm of what's like current, you know, and like, you know, you don't want to just jump off to something completely. And you also kind of don't want to do something that's everyone else is doing. I mean, it'll probably work that's how the industry is. They want the same repetitive thing, but just my inspirations and, you know, me as an artist, I've always wanted to just be a little bit different, you know?
One thing that I always say about you is like, your edits are so good still to this day and you don't DJ as much. So it's like, if I wasn't DJing, it would be harder for me to be able to relate to, oh, well, like this vocal really works and the people sing it, or I really like this build, but the drop doesn't hit as hard in the club. Mm-hmm. So maybe I need to make it harder. So I think it's really interesting that you could make these really playable, really good edits without being out as much, because I don't know if I could do that if I wasn't out in the club every weekend type thing. So like your ear, you said like you have a good ear. You clearly have a really good ear.
Right? Yeah, it's definitely made it a little bit more difficult to stay relevant with like the music when you're not out playing. The whole reason I ever started DJing was because I wanted to play my own music, my own edits and stuff like that. You know, I was like, where can I play? How can I let people hear this besides MySpace and whatever? So like, that's why I started DJing. But like when you stop, you kind of don't know how like this, how the songs work and the, like how your edits work in the club. So what I'll kind of do is if I'm at a place, I'll go up to the DJ and I'll just be like, hey, do you got any Pat C? I'm sure we all kind of do stuff like that. And I'll have them play it. And then, you know, they're always 9 out of 10 times they have something and they'll play it. And that's the way I kind of get the reaction of how people, you know, play. And I'll, you know, people will take videos and stuff and send it to me. So that's really my only way to really tell how my edits sound. And you kind of go based off of that, you know, and that's all I really have. If I go, you know, I go out and, you know, I'll hear some podcasts and mix shows and stuff like that too. And kind of get an idea of what sounds good there, but like, you don't know, have a crowd reaction. So when I'm out, I have to kind of just do that. You know, it's the only way to really tell. Yeah.
Well, I think also like being on DMP, you could go look at what edits that you've created have been the most popular for the last year or 30 days or whatever it might be. So that helps too. It helps me because sometimes I'll create something and I'll be like, oh, that, like, I don't really play it. But then it'll go like top 5 on DMP. I'm like, wow, maybe I should play it because everyone else seems to really like it type thing. Or vice versa, where I'll make something like, yo, this is fire. Like, this is going to be really good on DMP. And it doesn't. It goes top whatever. It doesn't go top 5 or, you know. So it's interesting. And I think that's a great tool for us.
It's always what you least expect when it comes to at least like DMP and like the edits and stuff. I try not even to like go by the charts and stuff like that, because it's never what you will think is going to hit is hits. I just try to do something that no one else is doing. Hey, no one else has used this vocal. Let me put this on something relevant, you know, and you kind of throw it in the wind and see, you know, if it hits, and, you know, just hope that it works. You try to make it as relevant and cool as possible. You know, I try to do like one edit for the club and one edit for the radio. And I kind of, you know, each week I don't have a set thing that I go in, I sit down and I, you know, like later on today, I have no idea what I'm going to do for like my edits, but I'm just going to kind of go with what I have. But I'm going to try to like do one that's like a really club edit, and one that like I try to get in everyone's crate. So I try to stay in the radio guys' crates and the club guys' crates, or the opener and the radio guys' crates, you know? So it's kind of like you do a little bit of both, and sometimes one hits and sometimes, you know, the other one hits. So it just kind of, you just got to take chances.
So you mind if I transition here, Kareem?
So I have one more follow-up question.
Go ahead.
So I think something I want to ask you, because you and I kind of create edits similarly, mm-hmm. where it's like we have an idea and we just create it, right? It could be any genre. It could be electro. It could be tech. It could be a hip hop blend, whatever it might be. I'm seeing more and more a lot of edit artists who are creating edits in one specific genre, and like that's all they do. Mm-hmm. What are your thoughts on that? Like, I kind of go back and forth on it. I think it's really awesome in some ways, and I think it kind of can hurt them a little ways, but I guess it really depends on what their goals are. But what are your thoughts on creating edits in that way?
Yeah, again, it comes down to your goals. I think if you're trying to be a strictly tech house artist or a strictly big room artist, well, then you're going to do big room stuff. You know, that's what you want to do. Me, I'm trying to just create. So like, I'm going to make everything. So hip hop, reggae, Mouton, deep house, tech, I'm doing it all because I just want my music to be out there. And I express my creativity in different, you know, genres. So I love all genres. So I'm going to be everywhere. But if I was just like, I have an alias where I play with like a mask and stuff, and I'm just doing deep house, I'm not going to make a hip hop edit under there because I want to just play deep house under that alias. So I'm just going to release edits that are deep house. So just you kind of got to know your audience in a sense, you know, and so, or what you want to do with that, you know, as an artist yourself.
Yeah, it's really interesting because like your versatility reminds me of like when we spoke to Chewy Cream, right? And then like also, but you're so different from every other editor that we've ever had on, because you're not in the club kind of taking, you know, what your experiences are and then translating them in production. So it's really a unique story. But you're obviously successful in what you do. What I wanted to get into is a little bit of the Beatbreaker Crooklyn Clan thing, because on our 100th episode, we recapped like Beatbreaker's story with Crooklyn Clan and kind of like how he came about. So, you know, how did you come through that whole story and whatnot?
Yeah. Yeah. And I listened to that. That was great. I love what you guys do, first of all. So he found me on MySpace. I was doing numbers, like crazy numbers. I was like number one. I don't even remember, so long ago. And then he found me. He's like, yo, I love your mashups, even though they actually sucked. I go back and listen to them and cringe as we all do with our older stuff. Like, how the hell did I do that? But anyway, I was doing very well. And he hit me up and he's like, yo, I can just put you on Crooklyn Clay and I'll pay you this and that. And I'm like, all right, let's do this. So I was making mashups with him. He was helping me a lot at first. He was telling me like, oh, you know, put this here. He really I owe him, like, I don't know, I don't even want to begin with everything I owe this guy, because he's the reason I've ever had a platform, and, you know, so I owe him everything. But he would teach me how to make edits club friendly, and how to, you know, because I was just making mashups and I didn't know what the hell I was really doing. I was just putting two songs together. There was no really like organization format. I was just putting vocal, beat. And then, you know, he kind of taught me how to put claps over this part that it was dead and just make it shorter, or like, you know, make this vocal, you know, put stuff before the drop and, you know, stuff like that. And I took that and I ran with it. I kind of made my own way of things. He taught me what bootlegs were when, you know, during the Dutch era, he was like, yo, I heard this guy Chucky is doing this and he's putting this song and just blending it. And then it goes into this, you know, this drop, this whole new drop. And, you know, and then I, you know, not to take credit, but he started that wave and I jumped in on that. And together we like blew up like what bootlegs were, you know, because it was really big at the time and no one was doing it. So he showed me how to do it. I fucking took it and ran with it. And I was just doing my own thing with that. And I was giving them to him. And he was tweaking it a little bit and stuff like that. And we'd release it and just everyone would go nuts over it. So like the whole Crooklyn Clan thing was just, it was insane. Like we were both making crazy amount of money. It was, you know, you had to buy individual tracks. So everyone was buying them. And we were releasing stuff that no one else had. So everyone was literally buying it. It was the biggest website out at the time. There's no competition. It was literally insane. And then from there, it was like, you know, I when Crooklyn shut down or whatever, you know, I did my own thing for a little bit and then DMP picked me up. So, you know, me and
Brooklyn Eras was like the Wild West, man.
It was crazy.
It was so crazy.
I remember talking to Ferrugio and him telling me how much money that he used to make. And I was like, yo, this is insanity. Yeah,
still to this day, no editor makes that money. Like, it's insane. Like, Beatbreaker was killing it, man. And I was getting a chunk of it every time I did it. He would pay me for that. And it was awesome. Yeah.
That was crazy. Like, Serato had just kind of come out. I mean, it had been out, but it was becoming popularized with like AM and Samantha Ronson and all them in the club. And then you'd go out and hear these DJs play all these mashups. And then like, you'd like write them down, like on your phone or whatever it might be. And then like, try to go and like find them. You couldn't find them anywhere. So then you found yourself at Crooklyn Clan where they actually lived. So you then had to buy, you're like, I need that record. So and you found yourself spending mass amounts of money on Crooklyn, and because it wasn't on a Napster or Soul Seeker, Kazaa, whatever was out at that time, none of that stuff existed there. It was all original music that was on those download sites. So you wound up in Crooklyn Clan on the record pool buy and stuff. So that's why all that money got pumped into there. It's crazy. Yeah.
Funny story with Scissorhands real quick. I was in Philly. So I was doing all these edits and going number one on Crooklyn Clan with a Beatbreaker. I was never by myself. I was always with him. And I never spoke to Scissorhands. And then maybe like 2016, 2015, I'm in Philly. And with Beatbreaker, I would always go to the gigs with him. And Scissorhands is there, you know, because I guess he's a Philly guy. And I'm just talking to him. He doesn't know who I am. And Beatbreaker plays one of my edits. And I'm like, oh shit, this is one of my edits. And he kind of looks at me funny. And he's like, what's your name? And I go, Pat C. And he goes, he almost turned white, like he's seen a ghost. And he goes, holy, like he like was speechless that I was a real person. He goes, I didn't think you actually existed. Like, I didn't think you were a real person. I just thought that he was making up a name. Like, Beatbreaker was making up a name just to throw, like, I don't know. Like, he was just so shocked that I was a real person. And he was, like, literally, like, mind blown. Like, it was insane. So that's just a funny story. Because I never put myself out there. So, like, how was he supposed to know? Like, I didn't have a big social media presence, you know? So, like, he didn't know I was a real person. It's just a funny story with that. Yeah.
Shout to Sizz and Riz, man. Those guys helped a lot of people for a long time, including me, you know, I was a young kid and met Riz at DJs in Jersey Shore. And he kind of like helped me, you know, whether he even knows it or not, he was like somewhat of a mentor for me. And it was like, this is this legendary New York City DJ. And he's like, I'm playing with him at DJs and other venues. And like, he helped me get my music on Crooklyn. So like, it's just cool to think back and reminisce about those times, because it really was super unique. And like, we're not going to see that again, I don't think, for people that are doing what we do as far as making edits and bootlegs. So,
yeah. It wasn't as common back then as it is now. Now I feel like everyone that has a computer is making edits and submitting them to like DMP and all the, there's way more record pools. That was the original record pool, if in a sense, you know. But and now, you know, they were paying for it. Now it's free. That's the download, so people have more access to it.
So real quick before we move on, what, like, do you think that some of the record pools are being watered down because so many people are submitting edits? And like, how do the record pools make sure that they aren't getting watered down?
Yeah, I think there's definitely some like not so good content on it, but again, there's something for everybody. So I think like it's okay to have, you know, 10 edits a day, 15 edits a day, as some, you know, some pools are printing out, as you know. But you know, if there's some really bad ones, then I think it's like, all right, you know, what are you doing putting this on? But I think somebody will play it. I mean, some people don't know the difference between a good and a bad edit, so someone's going to download it. So I think it's okay to have that once in a while. But as long as overall, I think your content is like percentage wise good for the most part, I think it's okay. You know, these guys get flooded with, I know you spoke to Anthony, you know how his emails are. They get flooded. People always hit me up like, oh, you know, they didn't post my edit. Can you do something about it? I'm like, well, I can't make them post it, but I can, you know, I'll give you their email or like tell you, maybe like approach them and introduce yourself and like do that. And maybe they'll look at you differently. You know, I can't make them post it. It just might not be that good, you know? So, but I, you know, they have so many submissions. So the fact that they can get 100 submissions and cut it down to 15 is, it's pretty good, you know, as far as not being watered down.
I think too, the person who's gatekeeping on all these sites is really important, right? It's got to be someone who really understands what good and what good is. I think most of the pools do a pretty good job. Mm-hmm. You know, obviously they have to post stuff from the record labels, originals, and certain things, and they can't post other things. But those edits that are going up, I think the person that's making the decision on whether or not they go up, that's a very important person, right? Because we want to make sure there's like a quality control as far as what gets out there. And then on top of that, I think the other thing is something DMTP does an amazing job with is we have such an incredible roster of exclusive artists. So there's what, like 7 or 8 of us now? If they only posted our edits, like they would still have a business type thing because we're all making a good amount of edits and submitting them every week. And generally the stuff from the guys who are exclusive is good. It's playable. It's in key. It sounds good. The levels are good. And I think that's the key to growing a successful pool is having those really strong exclusive artists.
Yeah. Yeah. I think they need that. I you don't see a lot. I think you see the most coming out of DMP. Other pools may only have like 4 or 5 guys, you know, and we're constantly, there's a couple of guys that come and go with us, but like, they're always trying to expand and like, you know, getting guys from overseas. So, you know, the kind of UK. So now you have a little bit of a UK audience, Australia. Now you got a little bit of Australia audience. You don't really
DMP
see
heavy like, in Australia.
Heavy in Australia. Shout out Dan and Champion.
Yeah, man.
Crushing it.
Those guys are awesome. We're going to try and get some of those guys on the show too, because I just love what they do. And it just seems like they have a great party scene out there and I'd love to hear more about it. So for sure, going to try and get some of those guys on the show. All right. So at this point, we're kind of nearing the end here. Every time we have a guest, we want to do these little quick hitters. So I got some quick hitters for you. It could be like first thing you think of, no pressure. So what is there a failure in your career that really stands out that helped you to grow or, you know, step up in some way?
Failure. So, that's tough. I think just in the DJ aspect, just not being on the level I've always aspired to be, which was like Vegas, you know, big rooms, you know, I've played for, you know, 1,000 people here and there, but like never like the 2,000, 3,000, 400,000, you know, rooms like that. So to me, that's like a failure. But like, I look at that as like an inspiration to just keep going because you want to play those venues and, you know, you can't let, just because they won't book you there, it's for a reason. Like you're just not doing something right. So what are you not doing right? Look into it. Why, you know, maybe you're just not good at playing the right songs or whatever. You're not getting the right venues. You're not, you know, it's all about that. But, you know, I've had some bad moments DJing. I've definitely messed up some gigs. I've definitely, the music has definitely stopped while I was playing and like, you never get booked again, you know? So things like that, it's always little setbacks, you know, and especially when they're big opportunities and you know that you can grow from those bookings, but we've all done that. So they're just little setbacks and you just got to keep going. You know, it's just don't stop. If this is what you want to do, don't stop. Just simple. And I've learned that. I've stopped and, you know, the love was still there when I came back. So it's like, why did I ever leave? You know? And, you know, it's because of the whole industry, but like I could have just kept going and just doing now, but just kept it going this whole time. And maybe I'd be at a little higher point in my career, you know, so just don't stop.
Yeah, I mean, you can't change it though. So you just gotta, you gotta work with what's in front of you and keep moving forward. And I think using that stuff as a way to push you forward is the way to go. So, all right, next one. What is your favorite genre at the moment?
At the moment, I listen to everything, so it's hard to have a favorite. I'm always bumping Kanye, regardless of what's happening. So I mean, that's like the biggest thing in my that's always being played. Besides like podcasts, I always listen to like you guys and stuff. But when it's music, it's always going to be like Kanye. It's going to be the Beatles. It's going to be like Linkin Park. Those are like my big three right there, you know. So, as far as like newer stuff, I'm always just throwing on mix shows and stuff like that. I don't really, individual songs don't really do it for me as far as like dance music and stuff. I like to listen to it mixed, you know, we're DJs. So we want to hear how things mix and transition and sound good one after the other. So, the deep house stuff will always, I've always been into deep house. So that's probably what I would say is what I listen to as far as like dance music and what's relevant in the DJ world.
Gary, what about you? Let's throw a curveball here. What are you into right now?
That was such a producer's answer, by the way.
That's what you're going to get from me. Yeah.
Like, what am I into right now? Like currently?
Yeah. Like, what's your favorite genre at the moment? What genre do you find yourself playing the most when you're not DJing?
Oh my gosh.
You're all over the place. So it's hard.
I know it's hard, but I really like down tempo. Some melodic house. I'm into that stuff on the reg. Like if I had a choice of like, Afro house too. I play a ton of Afro house in my car. And like I said on the podcast before, like Shimza and Themba, I've been listening to a lot of lately. I don't know if you know Themba, but check him out. Super dope. He's got a bunch of stuff out. Tone Set actually put me onto a couple of his tracks a couple of weeks ago. Really, really good. So like the stuff that I can't get away with in the club, that's the stuff I'm listening to at home.
I'm gonna shock you with my answer. I've been just listening to hip hop, like
I know you have
a lot. Heavy. I don't know what like flipped the switch for me, but
the Drake and 21 Savage album. I think that was the turn. Like I don't know if that completely turned you around, but that was a part of it.
That was definitely a big part of it. I've been like just digging through records, like full albums in the gym. Like I just listened to I've been listening to the Metro Boomin album like nonstop. I just think it's dope. Like it's not something I'm going to play a lot of in the club, but when I'm in the gym, it gets me hype and I just like listening to it.
I don't know one song from it. So maybe on my run today, maybe that's what I gotta listen to.
All right, there you go. All right. Next question. What is one album that changed your life? Any genre?
Oh, well, it's going to have to be College Dropout because that's what got me into producing. So, you know, anything to do with EA just changes my life. But that's the one that got me started. The moment I heard that Chaka Khan sample, it made me want to produce and here I am. Oh.
Awesome. It's funny. You and I both have that like hip hop start. It's just interesting how everyone has like a different entry point and you and I are similar.
That's
what
was cool at the time, you know, so. Yeah, we were on the same age. That's what was cool. There was house music wasn't as cool as it, you know, as it is now, as it was then. Everyone was into hip hop. So
yeah, like 140 BPM was big then.
That was huge. Yeah.
And like the 132 to 134, like not that you were weird listening to that, but like that was a different set of people. Let's put it that way.
Like I don't want to go to the techno club. That was like real. Yeah,
techno is the big word.
It
for
was
that.
Techno.
Yeah. You'd go into like the other room. And like that's where you'd hear that stuff. There was heavy drug use being done in there. It was fun, but predominantly at that time, hip hop was on the forefront of everybody's brain.
Also, all the techno clubs used to always have like the side hip hop room. And
that was the best.
I'd go out and always find myself in like the little tiny hip hop room, just like my friends would be MIA. I'd be in the hip hop room. Like, guys, what are
they like? You guys remember Hunka Bunka hip hop room? Like that little, I don't know if you ever even went there.
I've only been there like once in my whole life.
Really? They had like this little room that was like the sickest and they would play all the hip hop and that's where I'd hang out most of the time. So I wasn't dealing with the shit in the main room.
Everyone was fist pumping and stuff. It was like, it was crazy in there, but then all the girls were grinding in the hip hop room. So, it was different.
That's hilarious. All right. What is one positive change that you would like to see in the DJ industry?
Well, pretty obvious. The whole promoting thing is not something I'm a fan of. I think it should be separate, promoting and DJing. If you have the ability to combine both, then that's great. That's more of a tool you can use. But I think to require, you know, again, I said this earlier, so I think to require DJs to, you know, bring people is something that should be faded away. Yeah. Essentially. So I think that'd be a positive change. It should just be more about the music. And I'd also like to hear more house music in the industry. I think that'd be in New York, at least, you know, and New Jersey. So I think.
Yeah.
Nice. You know, all right. Last one.
What we do, so.
Yeah. Last one that we kind of ask everybody is just, what is some advice that you would give to a DJ that's either looking to break into the industry or looking to kind of level up their career?
I think just be persistent and just do it your way. Don't really, you know, follow your heart, follow like your cliche, follow like your dream, and like do it the way that you see it. If you see yourself as someone who wants to be, you know, play a festival, then like talk to people in that industry and like network that way. If you want to just play like city clubs, if you want to be the next Rick Wonder, well, hit up Rick Wonder, hit up people that he knows, hit up like, you know, like stick to like the route of where you want to be and like do it your way. You know, if you don't want to hit them up directly because you're shy, go see them in person, buy them a drink, you know, do whatever you have to do. Like just be consistent, be persistent, put out content, which is very, very important nowadays, whether it's edits, whether it's reels, whether it's whatever the case is, just stay relevant and be persistent. It's the best I can give.
Love it.
Yeah. I think that's such solid advice. To piggyback on it, there's a million ways to be successful in this industry. Mm-hmm. Find your lane, find what you want to do, and don't worry about how someone else got there or how quickly mm-hmm. they got there. Mm-hmm. Your career is your career and it's going to happen on your time. Be patient, mm-hmm. focus on the things that you want to do and what you think is best for your career, and you're going to succeed.
And so don't worry about time. I think time is something that we have a lot of as DJs. As far as like our age, I think you can be 50 and become a successful DJ. So like, just because you feel like you're 26 or 27 or 30 or 35, don't feel like it's over for you, because, you know, look at like, you know, DJ Boris is like 60. Tiesto is like 50, you know, like there's people that can just be, you could be whatever. It's one of those things that there are no boundaries as far as like age and when you can start and when you can be successful. That's what.
Love it.
Awesome.
Patsy, is there anything that you would like to promote before we shut it down here?
Patsy Music on Instagram. That's pretty much it, man. On all platforms, I believe it's probably the same: SoundCloud, Mixcloud, the whole nine.
Yeah. We'll put links to all your stuff. Also, guys, podcast sponsored by Digital Music Pool. If you guys want to sign up and test out DMP for the first month, we have a code in the show notes for $9.99 for the first month. All of Pat's edits, all of my edits. We've gone through the list of all the other artists who are on there a bunch of times, but we love DMP. We know you guys are going to love DMP. So check it out. Give it a shot. See what you think. All right, man. We appreciate you jumping on the show. I think this conversation has been really great. But yeah, let's wrap it, man. So my name is Kareem.
Gary W.
For Pat C. Thank you guys for listening, and check us out next week. Peace.
All right, guys. Peace.